Welcome to the Game OST Podcast, a postmortem for video game music examining its influence over the gamers and the sagas the music helped create. Let's get to our hosts, Andrew and Daniel.
Welcome to the Game OST Podcast.
Good claps, lots of claps. Hello.
That's the sound of someone drinking a Coke. Daniel, see if you can tell the difference between someone drinking a Coke and cheering, okay? Example A.
That's probably both.
No, don't answer until you've heard both examples.
Oh.
Example B. Get it? They're the same.
Yeah. Oh, you're so funny. Anyways, so we lied.
No, we didn't.
We did, because...
No, we didn't.
We did, because last week we said...
Killer Instinct?
Or 2 weeks ago, we said we were going to do Killer Instinct.
Yeah.
Like, we were really hinting at it, and now this week, there is no Killer Instinct.
Isn't there?
No, there is none.
There's no Killer Instincts?
No, we're not going to play Killer Instinct this time. Because Andrew thought it'd be a good idea for me to pick something that was lesser known to him, so I decided to go with...
Killer Instinct.
No. I decided to go with East 1 and 2 for the TurboGrafx. And there she is.
So tell us about East, because everyone's so familiar with it.
Everyone is super familiar with East. So anyone who grew up in the 90s and was privileged enough to have a TurboGrafx... which super expensive system when it came out.
If you're privileged, please tweet at us at the Game OST at the Game OST.
I actually never got to own a TurboGrafx.
Wait, when's the first time you played East?
Oh God, I literally don't know. The first time I actually beat East, was in my college years. Whenever I went back and like played the first two games on TurboGrafx, downloaded them on the virtual console on Wii, which I thought was really weird that it had TurboGrafx games, but I was like, oh, it's East. I love that game,
wait,
I think.
Wait, so you played it, you first played it on the Wii? Like the first Wii?
When did you get a Wii?
It
had the TurboGrafx virtual console. We're not going to talk about the Wii thing. You can ask me too many questions. No, it doesn't matter when I played it.
Okay.
What matters is that I played it and... It was through a strong sense of nostalgia that, you know, I felt like I just needed to play all of them.
Ah.
And I did.
That's interesting. You felt nostalgic for a game that you've never played before.
That's what I'm trying to tell you. I did play it. I played it when I was a kid, but I never got to own it because I couldn't buy like an $800 console when I was a young boy.
Okay.
So it was a...
So where did you play it before college?
It was just a friend's place.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
Okay.
But I had always liked the music from it, so whenever I would find it online, I would listen to it. Because there was a website that hosted and had like this weird collection of video game music that I found, and there was a lot of East. And I was like, oh, this is really cool. And so...
Should we talk about the pronunciation controversy?
God. That is probably one of the more annoying things. Whenever it blatantly says the name in the first game on TurboGrafx, it says East.
It says it with a voice?
It says it with a voice. Yeah,
wow.
It's TurboGrafx, yeah.
Wow.
It says East. It does not say Yeast, which is by far my most hated version of the pronunciation.
That's a strong pet peeve, I would say.
It very much is.
Especially if there's a voice that's why, you know, modern Final Fantasy, everyone knows how to pronounce the names. But, you know, back before they had voice acting, everyone was just like, oh, we don't know how anything's pronounced. And, you know, now we know. So don't say it wrong. Right. God.
I don't know. I've also heard like wise. Like Y-S, and they pronounce it like wise. I'm like, okay,
I'm just
I guess.
Call it Y-S.
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 I feel like that's a safe one.
I don't know. Maybe part of the confusion is the whole translation issues. Because how would you even write that in Japanese?
They write it Y-S.
But there is no Y. Well, anyway.
Right. Well, but I'm saying they literally write it out as in like Y-S. Like they don't.
Oh, there's no characters?
I don't think so, no.
Oh, that's interesting.
From what I've seen and everything, every title is Y-S. They don't
But
have...
if you did, if you did write it, it would just be like I-I-S.
Yeah.
Right?
Probably. Yeah. If you actually had to like write it out to pronounce it or something.
Yeah. Yep. All right. Should we dive in?
Yeah, absolutely. Before you play the first track, though, I think we should talk about what is happening in the game.
Okay. Good idea.
Because when you start out, the intro has actually changed a couple of times because the first game and second game actually have been remade or remastered. Like, I don't even know. I've literally lost count. There are so many different remakes of the first two games that they've changed the story a little bit into something more of like Adol, the main character, has crash landed on a ship. And so he is like washing to shore, basically. Oh. That's like the newer version.
Right.
The original, I can't say the original, but the one that was on the PC engine / TurboGrafx was, you just showed up on a boat. He's an adventurer and okay. There's not really any rhyme or reason to why he's there. He just kind of shows up, which I guess is why they wanted to make like more of a backstory to it.
Right.
But I don't know. I kind of like that. I mean, he's an adventurer, you know, it's his first big adventure. So.
I get a Dark Savior vibe from all this.
Yeah. And we could talk about that too.
We should talk about that.
Yeah. Dark Savior is something we'll cover at some point, I'm sure. But no. So once you get off the boat, basically you find out that, well, you don't find out right away, but there's a fortune teller.
Just like in real life.
Right. There's a fortune teller in the town who tells you that basically that you need to save the world.
Yeah. Happens all the time.
Right. And you're just like, excuse me? So anyway, the song that plays is the one that I have first up there.
Oh, this is really good.
Yeah. So this is one of the more like, it almost has like an 8-bit sound to it, right?
It does. Those bells, though, are really good.
So, yeah, that song basically is like a really small loop, but it's really cool and really atmospheric, and you really get a vibe for how like serious the situation is.
It sounds very fortune tellery.
It does in a way. Mm-hmm. Well, you hear it in a couple of different places, but it's typically like kind of a sad theme because of
Tears of Sylph.
Right, Tears of Sylph.
Who's Sylph? Yeah. What is Sylph? Is that like the mythological Sylph thing?
Oh, I don't know. I mean, it plays in too many different locations for me to be like, oh, it's this, you know.
Yeah.
But after that, you depart and you go into the town and you have to like get a sword and shield and stuff to like take off into the wilderness, in which case then it's your first steps towards war, as the track is called. And this track is what like got me hooked into the series
as
a kid.
Pretty good track.
I mean, it plays in the main field where you're like leveling up and stuff to
this reminds me of an 80s Italian disco, honestly, though.
80s Italian disco?
Yeah.
I don't know if I get that
vibe.
Dude,
you could totally put this track over like a dance scene in Scarface and no one would know the difference.
I mean, you're probably right.
Yep.
Well, this...
You could even put words over it. Rush, rush, yeah, yo.
This track you hear a lot at the beginning because there's lots of kind of grinding, I guess.
Yeah.
But grinding in East is a lot more different than grinding in a typical, like,
right.
JRPG because they have this, I don't know if there's an official name for it, but it's like the bump system. So instead of actually fighting or like pressing a certain button to swing a sword, you're literally running into the enemies at an angle,
yeah,
so that you don't get hurt but they get hurt.
Yeah. And, I remember seeing that when you were playing it, I was like, oh, that's pretty unique.
Yeah, it's
but
it's,
it also reminded me of Secret of Mana because it's very much like an open field movement kind of thing where
Well, whenever you're fighting your enemies, it doesn't have to like take away from the atmosphere, right? Like
right.
like Final Fantasy or
right,
something
right,
like
right.
that.
Yeah. Suck it, Final Fantasy.
No, right. I'm not knocking Final Fantasy. It's just like, you know, when you go into a battle in Final Fantasy in whatever game, it's or in anything before 12 or whatever,
right?
You know, you
aren't in the real world anymore.
Yeah,
you're on the battlefield.
It transports you to another place, basically,
right.
or it feels
yeah.
like. but yeah, and that's what I like about action RPGs is that, you know, you're in the action always.
Yeah.
You don't have to you don't have to get transported elsewhere to fight your battle.
And luckily, there are no more RPGs where you get transported to a battlefield.
No,
anymore.
I don't know. I kind of miss it after replaying through Super Mario RPG.
Uh-huh.
I definitely miss that.
Absolutely.
But anyways, you hear that track a lot at the beginning because, you know, there's a ton of grinding just to feel strong enough because those enemies, they're pretty rough at first.
Like, how many hours of grinding would you say?
Oh, it's not hours. I mean, you can beat the game in... You can probably beat the game in like 6 to 7 hours.
Okay.
The first one, that is.
Okay.
But
when do you get to the palace?
The palace. Well, that's the thing is like you. Whenever I first played it, you know, I didn't really feel like I wanted to grind a whole lot because I wanted to explore, mm-hmm. which is what's really cool about the game. So you know, you're fighting kind of the same level enemies as you're going to explore. You end up running into another town. Which, you know, doesn't really give you a whole lot of information except for this dude's missing an artifact and this old lady's missing, like, this girl, right?
Ah.
And you're like, okay, that's kind of weird. So you go through that town, and then there's higher-level enemies, which is like, I'm glad I kind of grinded a little bit. But then as soon as you walk into the palace, you know, there's not really a whole lot going on. There's just a wall in front of you. And you're like, I don't know what to do here.
Dude, the water drops are intense.
And this is the only version of the game where they have that, which is why this is my favorite soundtrack of the remasters.
Okay, can we talk about the composer for half a second? Because this is amazing.
I'm pretty sure this is... I don't know if he composed a soundtrack or if he just arranged it for this version, mm-hmm. but it was Yuzo Koshiro, which is the same dude who did Shinobi.
Ah!
So...
Nice.
For Sega Genesis, that is.
Oh, we need to do Shinobi, too.
Yeah. Oh,
I'm
yeah.
taking production notes right now. too many good games
so,
out there.
So, from what I understand, he had a lot to do with this version of the soundtrack, whether he had composed it or not. I mean, he obviously had, you know, creative freedom to kind of make it sound better than the old school, like, PC-88, PC-98 versions.
This sounds amazing.
So, this is another really good track, and, you know, you want to just stay in here and listen to this song, but you kind of just stay in there for no reason because you just see a bunch of statues on the wall and you don't really know what to do with it. So eventually you get an artifact that lets you touch one of the statues and it transports you to another area of the palace, which then you fight a boss. And I don't know if...
what boss is it?
I forget his name, but he's like a wizard. Mm. He's a wizard.
You're a wizard, Harry.
But, yeah, so this is the song that plays when you fight the wizard.
I can totally picture Hagrid, like, rushing at Harry right now. He's going to beat the shit out of him.
So, you know, what's hard about the bosses is that...
You can't rush them, right?
I mean, that's the whole point. You have to.
Oh, no.
It's like bump damage. So
you
have to find a way to not take as much damage as mm-hmm. you're putting out, you know?
Yeah.
And... all the bosses in that get on this in this game are like that. You constantly have to like learn their moveset and just know when to like
oh man that
attack
arp.
And run.
Do you hear that arp though?
Oh yeah,
that's a killer.
Yeah, and then this
yeah.
freaking guitar comes in.
Man, you love a good guitar solo.
Yeah, yeah.
That's the something I noticed about Daniel.
Yeah, I love like old school sounding guitar solos in video games,
like 80s guitars.
Yep,
yep. That's where it's at. 80 cents and 80s guitars.
Yep, yep. That's right.
I like this because it's like energetic, but it's not menacing. Like,
yeah,
a lot of bosses' music today is like really dark, and you're just like, okay.
And
well,
it's not supposed
I'm
to sound nowadays. It's not supposed to sound like cool. It's
right.
supposed to just sound like ominous, right?
Right.
And I mean that's great and all if that's what you're going for, but I really prefer the.
This reminds me so much of Secret of Mana somehow. I don't know why. It's very different, but it's
well. No, I mean you know, East. I don't want to say it alone started it, but mm-hmm. Ys was a big pioneer for like RPGs in general.
Yeah.
So was Dragon Slayer and other of Falcom's
Dragon
games.
Dragon Quest too.
Well, yeah, Dragon Quest and Final Fantasy. You know,
yeah.
all those games were really big. In this driving force. So you know, these composers and these game makers were all taking inspiration from so many different places back then.
For sure.
And I feel like it's kind of lost its flair at this point because, yeah, you know, everybody's done everything now.
And now people are just doing orchestral trash, basically.
And I'm so sick of it. I'm so sick of it.
What makes you angry, Daniel?
Dark Souls music is what makes me angry. I love the Dark Souls. I love FromSoft. I love their Souls series, but man, I'm sick of hearing choirs.
Yeah, we're tired of choirs, that's true. But how do you feel about like nostalgic kind of remixes? Like, let's take Hyrule Warriors, for instance.
I feel like with Hyrule Warriors, they're all original tracks for the most part. And they have a Temple of Time remix.
Yeah.
Which it plays on.
Wait, let me turn it out here.
It plays on the Ocarina of Time version of the song, but it doesn't actually have the same melody. It just kind of sounds like it because of the I guess the choir
and
the
break beats.
Oh yeah, the break beats that were in Ocarina of Time.
I love Ocarina break beats. Remember when Link is like learning to DJ right before the Shadow Temple? Oh wait, that was just me. Okay, sorry.
No, that's the thing, is like I'm okay with like a sort of remix or homage to stuff like that. I mean, people can do it well and people can do it horribly, but yeah. I think whoever did the Tecmo Koei, you know, who was in charge of that, I think they did really well. I don't know who composed it. It wasn't Koji Kondo.
Absolutely not.
But
he might have composed Sia's or Lana's theme, maybe.
Well, I mean, at least one of his tracks was in the game because there was the stock like Zelda theme in there somewhere, right?
But it might have been arranged at the same time.
Oh no, it definitely was. Yeah. It was not arranged by him.
We love you, Team Ninja, coming to the show.
We love you, Team Ninja. Yeah, it sucks because I don't really know a lot of those composers on the Team Ninja side of things and Tecmo Koei, because I don't know if Team Ninja was on Hyrule Warriors. I think it was just Koei. But anyways, back to East.
Oh, okay, yeah.
We can get into all that, the nitty gritty.
I just wanted to have a little bit of a tangent.
No, that's fine. I could talk about how awful game music is nowadays anytime.
Yeah.
But anyways, after you beat that boss, you go further into the depths of the palace and you realize you're in this like labyrinth castle type thing. It's like an underground castle, and I think that's when this next track plays.
Yeah,
so this track, you know, you just fought a boss.
Yeah.
And the track is pretty upbeat. But this one has a very ominous tone to it.
It does, but it also kind of sounds like the music that plays after you beat a boss and then the whole palace is like falling apart. So you have to get out of there quickly.
Right. I mean, that's kind of what this feels like because you're running around like crazy.
Yeah.
Because the enemies down here, I mean, the level cap, you know, it goes up right here.
Yeah.
So it's like you either need to go back outside of the palace and grind a little bit,
okay,
or hopefully you're ready for this. Mm. But I mean, if you can beat that first boss without much trouble, then you're probably good.
Okay.
But yeah, this part is very lengthy, and you find a lot of good armor and weapons and stuff in here.
Cool.
So, you know,
ooh. Oh,
I love this track.
This part's
good.
Oh
my God. I love this track so much. All the breakdowns, like, and the cool thing about the PC Engine soundtrack, or the TurboGrafx soundtrack, is that all these tracks end and then restart. It's not like a loop, so it's literally a full song that they arranged,
that's
and then
actually really different.
And then it ends.
Can you even do that in FMod?
You know, I don't know. I mean, yeah, you could have a song end and then restart, but nowadays no one's going to want that, you know.
Right.
Me too, but they really only did that on the Saturn with games, and not just Falcom, but you know, a lot of companies, Sega even did it for Virtua Fighter, you know.
Really? I remember that.
Yeah, those tracks end and then restart.
Okay, but in a fighting game that doesn't work, because you need to have constant... Like,
I would say so too, but with the way Virtua Fighter's built, the health bars are very small,
right?
So you can defeat your opponent pretty quickly. But yeah,
you're giving me flashbacks.
But yeah, so that track is really cool, mainly because it's ominous, but yet it's super. It really feels like you're you're trying to like get in and get out as fast as you can.
It's a really good melody.
Yeah. I love this song. I love this soundtrack so much.
Daniel is starting to make love to the song.
Basically. So I think I skipped the cavern that you go into.
Mm. Is that an optional thing?
No. The track is kind of forgettable. Oh. I mean, well, I say it's forgettable. But it's more of a – anyone who wants to listen to it, definitely check it out because I think it's called the – you know, I'm not even going to try and remember what the name is. Mm. But it's a great song that plays because it's really atmospheric. Mm. But it doesn't really have a melody that I get attached to. It's gotcha. Just kind of an atmospheric song that you expect
That's cool.
from a cave, right?
Right.
Which is really cool in a game that old.
I do like my cave sounds. Like I know you don't like Pokemon, but that Mount Moon Cave theme?
From, like, the first game? I have a little soft spot for some of the Pokemon
and
music.
Then,
but
and then the cave music from FF6 is really good, too.
That is very true.
Yeah.
Anyone who has not listened to the FF6 soundtrack, you
We're
need to
do
that
one.
To be cultured.
We're not going to cover FF6. There's too much.
Well, we could do it in parts, but I
want to do, like, Final Fantasy in several parts, but not focus on one game particularly, you know?
I'm okay with that. I think that's probably a good idea. Yeah. I mean, I kind of wanted to do that with the whole Falcom East library, but...
Like, honestly, with the amount of games of Final Fantasy I've played, which I think is all of them, I could probably do, like, 5 or 6 episodes, maybe. Or maybe we could do, like, special ones that are, like, an hour long and,
yeah.
and just do 3 of those, you know?
Yeah. I mean, that might be a good idea.
That would be cool.
It's just, I'm not as familiar with Final Fantasy as you are. I'm familiar with,
right.
like, the first... Well, I'm familiar with the first 6, at least.
Right, yeah.
To a certain extent. But then after that, I kind of go off the
yeah.
radar
well,
a little
Well, the
bit.
Music gets less good after that because well, they focus more... They do. They don't focus as much on composition. And well, it's like, if you look at, like, Kuja's theme versus anything from 8 or anything from 9
mm-hmm.
or, I'm sorry, 9, 10 or 7 even... It's people, very gimmicky. It's like
some people are going to be like, "Ultimacia's theme was my favorite theme ever."
Those people can suck eggs.
And honestly, I don't like Ultimacia's theme. So
and I love sucking eggs.
Final Fantasy VIII is my favorite soundtrack, by the way.
It's of those. It's very. It has the least amount of gimmicks, I would say. It's strong compositions.
If the audience doesn't know, I'm a huge fan of reverb, and Final Fantasy VIII is literally just reverb.
It's basically a synthwave album
yeah.
with a little bit of jungle beats in there.
Yeah, which I'm not a fan of, but yeah.
I love that song.
There are a lot of tracks in 8 that I really love, but
we'll start with 8 when we do our Final Fantasy.
Oh, God. I bet if I went from like if I listened to like 5 and 6 again, I'd be like, okay, this is better.
5 is pretty good. 6 is really 6 is gimmicky, but not in a bad way. It's like oh, we're composers. We want to be professionals. We're gonna push ourselves to do better art than what we have done.
Right, right, and that's great.
God, yeah. Nobu is. I'm sorry. I think his name's Nobuo.
Yeah, there
right?
you go. Yeah.
He is so freaking... He's got to be like a genius, right? Like literally a genius because he has come up with so much music in his life that is so influential and like...
Well, I think it also, you know, he's like their in-house
yeah,
sound guy.
Right. But for a good reason too.
Yeah, for a good reason. I mean, he helped them... create the franchise.
If he ever dies, and I mean if, there could be riots in the street.
I feel the same way. I wish it were the same way with like Falcom's in-house band because
hey, you never know.
That's true. The Falcom JDK band is probably my favorite group of composers ever in video game history.
Okay, this is jumping out at me, so I want you to talk about the final battle.
Is that the one next?
No, there's Tower of Shadows, but I'm more interested in Final Battle.
Okay. So
Ooh.
After the Tower of Shadow of Death, you fight Dark Fact, one of the coolest boss names ever. And he is just like this vampiric looking guy.
I want to Google it, but I'm pretty sure it would just be like a website about what happens when you turn off the lights.
A Dark Fact, yeah. No, he's super intimidating. And in the PC Engine TurboGrafx version, you literally, like in this version, you literally have like small cutscenes.
Oh, cool.
So it's not like cutscenes where it's like visuals going on.
Yeah.
Some of them are, but very rarely. This is just like his face comes up on the screen and he talks to you, and it's super creepy.
That sounds awesome.
Yeah, it's just like, oh god, this guy is like for real, right?
Yeah. God, but, this is amazing too.
Yeah, and this boss fight is extremely hectic because the floor is like disappearing underneath you as you're fighting him.
That trumpet totally reminds me of Alphaville.
There's some more
dude,
solos.
I'm really glad you picked this out because this is amazing.
Yep, I'm hoping other people think so too. It's such a freaking good, it's such a good starting place for Ease.
So is that the final battle though?
That's the final battle of the first game. The thing the thing about the TurboGrafx PC Engine version is it's the first two games on one CD.
Gotcha. So it just leads seamlessly into each other?
Yeah, literally seamlessly. I think that's probably one of the... It is my favorite version of the combination because of how seamlessly it goes into one another. It doesn't go into a credits sequence after you beat the first game.
Cool.
It does the credits after you beat both.
Ah, but that's not how it was in Japan?
That is how it was in Japan, on this version only.
So how did they do that? Or why did they separate it into two games if it plays as one?
Just because of their hardware limitations when it was a younger series.
Oh, okay.
Because, I mean, it came out in like 88, I think, 1988, on the PC 88.
That's my birthday. Just kidding.
I think it came out back then. It may have been even earlier, honestly, but it was on the PC. It was on the either on the FM Towns or the PC 88 first. I don't remember which PC it was.
Okay.
But it was only the first game, and then they also released the second game on the same system. Mm. But then when this came out, you know, it's a CD, so it has more, it can hold more.
Right.
So they just went ahead and remastered it and put it together on one. So why waste your time putting a credit sequence in between the games whenever you can just have everything at the end?
Right.
So the cool thing about this is right after you beat Dark Fact.
That's a cool thing already, the fact that they reprogrammed a game that already existed. Do you know how rare that is now? It's like, we're going to port this to the Virtual Console. It's done. Like,
right.
They do like the minimum at best.
Right. Know? Yeah.
I have so much anger for Nintendo these days.
Yeah.
It's just like, you have so many good IPs that are just sitting on the shelf that could easily make you money.
Mm-hmm.
And they just, what do? Make new
Man, it wouldn't matter if they released F-Zero nowadays and it was bad. Because people would buy the crap.
That's
what I'm trying to say.
F-Zero, what else have they left on the shelf? Like Star Fox and Metroid, practically.
Yes. I mean, Star Fox got that new one, but it wasn't flying off the shelf.
Yeah, but that's because they tried to change it so much. They need to get back to their grassroots and do Super Nintendo over again.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. That would be, I mean,
yeah.
I wouldn't even care if it was the same graphics as Super Nintendo.
those graphics would sell today, I think. People are looking for that.
You know, I think you're very, very right about that.
It's so frustrating how you have this, like, this whole corporate side of gaming and then the indie side, and there's not enough in between where it's like,
oh, there's like zero in between.
Yeah.
There's like zero crosstalk, I guess.
Yeah.
There's like zero crosstalk in
it's
that.
It's pretty frustrating.
Yeah, it is.
But hopefully we're moving towards an era where that won't be as big of an issue.
Because
what I hope for is that the indie games will learn from all the major game companies and do their version of that, even though they don't have the funds.
Mm-hmm.
Like the Castlevania guy.
Yeah, he did like that Kickstarter for, if anyone's interested in that, you should definitely check it out. Oh,
I think they met their goal.
No, it's long since met its goal, but I'm saying keep your eye on it because, I mean, they're definitely going to sell copies of it afterwards.
Mm-hmm.
I forget what it's called, but it was the same guy who did like Symphony of the Night and stuff like that. So,
and it was a whole new Castlevania game,
right?
With exactly what Castlevania fans want,
right? And it looks a lot like Symphony of the Night, which is exactly what I wanted because that's my favorite game of
exactly.
the series.
Yeah,
which we also need to talk about at some point because wow, what a soundtrack!
I think we're up to 10 games now.
Yeah, seriously, all this teasing, no one's gonna know what's coming up next.
All right, wait.
But you should play that song before the final battle.
I was just about to. So
because
talk about it.
Yeah, this track is something you hear for, it could be hours because
this would take you hours.
There are like 20 to 30 floors of this tower, and this is the only song you hear that entire time. And to me, it never got old. but. That's just because there's a lot of like breaks, like, you know, you talk to people and get like cutscenes.
I'm
stuff.
Laughing and really hard because this does not sound like a video game song at all.
I know. It's so good though. I love it. This is probably one of the coolest like.
This
tower
sounds
themes.
Like an instrumental song for like some 80s pop singer album. Like literally. Like,
I mean,
what
yeah,
the
it
kind
of does
this?
Really.
Yeah. I would never have guessed the title is The Tower of the Shadow of Death.
It's very Japanese. I love it.
Wow, man, this is crazy. So you hear this for hours?
You hear this, it could be hours, depending on how lost you get, because it's a huge labyrinth. It's literally 20 to 30 floors.
Yeah.
And the coolest thing about this tower is, you know, you're in it, you immediately get in, and they have to lock the doors behind you. Because like the people that are like guarding it, they're not really guarding it per se, but they say once you go in, you're not coming back. Like you either destroy the evil or you die, right?
Cool.
Because if you go back outside, the monsters are going to run rampant.
Mm.
So
I like that trope.
Yeah, I know it's crazy, right?
Yeah.
It's basically like sealing off a portal, which is still really cool to me. But when you get to the top, that's when you fight Dark Fact, and then that really awesome boss battle theme plays. Mm. And it's like, wow, this is kind of a nice change of pace from the song I was just hearing for like 3 hours, right?
Yeah. Okay, wait. Can we talk about this part, though? Wait for it. Or listen to this solo.
Oh, there it is. That's why I like this song.
This is, not only is it going back left and right, but it's like, that was really cool. Like,
and it's so short, too.
Yeah, it's really short, but it like... And I heard that, I was just like, whoa, this is like next level.
Yeah, Falcom was ahead of the game, that is for sure, with their music.
Yeah, the reverb on that was really cool.
What track do I have after the final battle? Because I totally forgot.
Well, we're getting close to time.
Oh, should we cut it for the first game?
Yeah.
Okay, so.
Pretty soon.
So what... what we're going to do for this, then, is we're probably going to do a two-parter.
Yeah, that's how that works.
No telling when we're going to cover the second game, even though the second game has some of my all-time favorite Falcom music ever.
We can do it sooner than later.
If anyone wants to listen to the Ice Ridge of Nulsha, probably the coolest song in all of East history.
This podcast,
no pun intended.
This podcast is like your excuse to find other video game nerds who like the same music as you. You're like, if you listen to this and you like it,
no.
Send me a like on OKCupid.
No, I'm just name dropping at this point, or song dropping, I guess.
Yeah. Well, I mean, these are really good songs, and obviously you have good taste. Otherwise, I probably wouldn't be a podcast with you.
Right, right. Yeah, but I think we should cut it here, because after hearing those from the first game, you can totally cover the second game in the same amount of time. So,
yeah,
we can totally.
So this has been East.
Yeah, this has been East 1. The TurboGrafx PC Engine port, however.
Yeah.
So keep that in mind.
Awesome. Okay, so are we going to tease what we're going to do for next week? Or?
Oh man, so we have so many options. We could do Killer Instinct.
Uh-huh.
We could do East 2.
Mm-hmm.
We could do
Gunstar.
We could do Gunstar Heroes. Yeah. Shinobi. Yeah, one of the many Shinobis.
There's lots of choices.
You know, we haven't even done a Sonic the Hedgehog game.
Oh
either.
Man, you're right. But I did play. Oh no, I didn't. That didn't happen.
Or we
redacted.
Could,
redacted.
We could also do a Mario RPG. So we talked about that too. Oh,
yeah.
We could do Metroid. We could do.
Oh yeah,
like,
yeah. Okay,
I mean,
you're right.
Okay, we just need to make a list and.
Yeah,
you know,
prioritize.
Yeah,
all right,
for real.
Well, this has been the Game OST. Thank you guys for listening. See you in time. Bye. Say bye, Daniel.
Goodbye.